Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Alpenglow Winter Speaker Series, coming to you live from beautiful Palisades, Tahoe. Our show's about to begin, so whether you're joining us in person or from the comfort of your living room, please find your seat and give a warm welcome to your host, Brendan Madigan.
What's up, everybody? Who's fired up for a show? Come on now, who's fired up for Brette Harrington? All right. Guys, my name is Brendan Madigan, and I'd like to welcome you to our third show of the 17th annual Alpenglow Winter Speaker Series. Thank you for coming. We've got an awesome show for you in store tonight. Let's give it up for the one and only Brette Harrington. But first, we've got throwouts. Everyone gets down with throwouts. Our throwers are lagging. All right, I'm throwing stuff out. Who wants some? Tracy's got a bag of goodies. Touchdown. All right, everybody, grab your seats. Who's feeling good tonight? All right, for real, y'all, how's everyone doing? It just snowed like 40 feet. How's everyone doing? Raise your hand if you're having an epic winter. Yep, Sierra Cement, it sucks. Okay, I'd like to thank our friends at Sierra Nevada, Got Winery, and Best Day Brewing for their generous donations tonight. The liquid awesomeness you're enjoying, 100% of those proceeds go to the Send It Foundation. Let's give it up for those guys. I'd also like to thank Alex and his crew from Mogrog Rotisserie in the back. Everyone know Alex? Not only is Alex a sponsor of the event, he provides us tasty food and he donates 15% of his proceeds to the nonprofit beneficiary of the evening. Let's clap for that. So as many of you know, can you hear me in the back? Come on, y'all, grab your neighbor and tell him to shh. This is a civilized crew. The Winter Speaker Series has a twofold goal. The first is to inspire and motivate athletes of all walks of life to chase their dreams in the mountains. The second is to educate about and raise funds for local nonprofits who are making a tangible difference in the North Lake Tahoe and Truckee community. Yeah. It's fun stuff. The equation is simple. A world-renowned athlete like Lynn Hill, Brette Harrington, Alex Honnold, Tommy Caldwell, go on down the line. A free, inspirational show. Awesome giveaways. And epic nonprofits. We can all get down with that, right? Our title sponsor this year is once again the friends from Tahoe Mountain Realty, a group of locals who understand the power of adventure storytelling and its ability to make appreciable change in our community. Let's give them a big round of applause for making this possible. And the brains behind Tahoe Mountain Realty, a lot of people think it's Jeff Brown. We love Jeff. But it's really Jasmine Watson. Jasmine's here tonight. Go ahead and stand up, Jasmine. Let's give Jasmine a big round of applause. Jasmine's here with her son, Jackson. And homie, we gotta tell you, you got an awesome mom. We're also proud to have the support of the North Lake Tahoe Resort Association. And I'd be remiss to not thank our generous host, Palisades Tahoe. Let's give it up for them. And I say this at each show, but the fact that we now have global brands sponsoring the Winter Speaker Series validates our work that the community is doing together. These include DPS skis. Someone's going to walk home with a $1,600 pair of skis tonight. Arc'teryx, Osprey Pax, Nerona, and Peak Design. Let's clap for them. But that's not it, and this is where I need everybody's help. We also have the support of some amazing local businesses. So when I say this business's name, for instance, Brette Harrington, what I'm going to ask everyone to do with me is clap afterwards. So when I say Brette Harrington, you say? That's good, but I'm thinking all as one. This is a community, right? So when I say Brette Harrington, you say? I'm thinking like simul-clap. Ready? So when I say Brette Harrington, you say? Yes. Some of us got it. The Tahoe Weekly. Mount Lincoln Construction. It's getting good. Moonshine Inc. Technical Equipment Cleaners. Emerald Bay Wealth Management. Ming Poon Photography. Also works at Tahoe Mountain Realty. We can clap for that again. Launchpad Consulting and Software Development. Evolve Design Works. And 101.5 KTKE Truckee Tahoe Radio. Okay, so family, can anyone tell me what this past Monday was?
Awesome.
It was awesome. But I'm thinking a little more visceral. Martin Luther King Day, yes, thank you. A mildly amazing human, right? And even though he's been gone for 50 years plus, his social commentary is still completely on point. One of my favorites is a question from King, a question that has always made me reflect personally and pause and assess. This question should elicit reflection, both in our individual lives and for society at large, especially when the world is like bananas and so polarized. It's simple and it's beautiful. King asks us that life's most persistent and urgent question is, what are you doing for others? I'm going to repeat that so everyone gets it. Life's most persistent and urgent question is, what are you doing for others? There's a lot of doing for others on display here tonight. Brette Harrington is volunteering her time to inspire our community. Brett's sponsors have generously donated almost $10,000 worth of giveaway prizes. There's all of you, both in person and online, who have ponied up hard-earned dollars to buy giveaway tickets to support the Send It Foundation. And then there's the Send It Foundation itself, tonight's nonprofit beneficiary, literally making the lives of cancer survivors better. These groups make our community awesome. So maybe collectively, if we honor King's question in our daily lives, we can do our part to perhaps make our community and the world just a little bit better of a place to exist in. So I leave you with, what are you doing for others? Break trail for your homie. Give your parent a hug. Just be a nice person. And with that, I'd like to introduce Caroline Scow, an amazing woman with amazing vision, the heart and the soul. There's many hearts and souls, but she is a major driver of the Send It Foundation. Let's give them a big round of applause, tonight's beneficiary.
My name is Caroline.
On behalf of our team at the Send It Foundation, we're thrilled to be here this evening. Thank you to Brendan and everyone at Alpenglow, the donor party, to the amazing Brette Harrington, and to all of you for joining tonight. Send It is an expression that inspires positivity, enthusiasm, pushing boundaries, and living life to the fullest. Born from the adventure sports community, Send It is what we say to encourage each other to go for it, go big, give it your all. The Send It Foundation was founded by longtime Truckee local and my older brother, Jamie Scow, when he was diagnosed with cancer at the age of 33. At 6'8", Jamie was larger than life, a familiar smiling face in this small mountain community. Upon his diagnosis, the expression Send It took on a whole new meaning for him. For Jamie, someday became today, and with every break in treatment, he skied and biked and paddled and just generally sent it. It was the pursuit of these adventures that brought him joy and strength through his illness and really made him feel alive when so much of his life had been compromised. His time in the outdoors became the light at the end of the tunnel while he was in treatment and gave him a source of strength to head into the next round. He also felt a unique type of isolation that really only comes with a diagnosis at this age. His vision was to bring these two worlds together, to bring the adventures that gave him so much strength to other young people in the cancer fight. And in the last year of his life, Send It was born. Send It provides outdoor adventures for young adult cancer fighters and survivors. Programs are multi-day adventures, bringing together 7 to 10 participants. Our trips are designed around activities like skiing and surfing, rock climbing and mountain biking, all to create a vital community through a shared experience. As young adults in their 20s and 30s, cancer patients this age are caught between the worlds of pediatric and adult oncology. The emotional and physical challenges for this age group are different. Issues like fertility, career planning, and financial independence are just some that set this group apart. Cancer strips the ability to do so much, and Send It is about giving that back. The outdoors provides a place for participants to push their personal limits and connect with themselves and their bodies in a new way. It's through these challenges that we discover our personal power and the strength and courage that lies within all of us. In September of 2015, we ran the first Send It adventure, a weekend of mountain biking and kayaking here in Lake Tahoe. Since then, we're proud to have completed 65 adventures, serving over 400 cancer patients and survivors from across the US. At Send It, we fundraise throughout the year to provide these programs free of charge for our participants. All lodging, travel, meals, gear, and instruction are included and made possible by our amazing community of donors, local partners, and volunteers. The overwhelming need for programs serving this population has become abundantly clear. With each program that we run comes an influx of applications, and our waitlist exceeds 700 patients nationwide. As we look ahead, it's our charge and our opportunity to amplify the Send It impact, to touch as many lives on that growing waitlist as possible. Send It started with Jamie's vision, and his spirit is so very much alive in everything that we do. But Send It has evolved, as he anticipated and hoped that it would. With every person who has had a hand in building it, who has come on a trip, led a trip, supported a trip from afar, and participated in creating these experiences. We may not have the scientific answers to increase survival rates and prolong the time after a diagnosis, but what we can do is create an experience that brings life, fun, and positivity to each day. To give a young adult an adventure, a connection, and an experience of feeling alive as a reminder that each day is a gift and to always send it. Check us out at senditfoundation.org, make a donation, spread the word, or get involved. It all makes a difference when we send it together, because nobody fights cancer alone.
That's pretty amazing, right, guys? So to give everyone some context, we spend a lot of July taking applications for the nonprofits to be part of the Winter Speaker Series, and I think it's safe to say when Send It, who's been a beneficiary in the past, gave their presentation, like we had to play at Super Pro and not cry at the table, but it was definitely hard, so we appreciate what they're doing. But let's give away some stuff, huh? What color ticket y'all want first? Hopefully I can read the numbers this time. All right, I got a blue ticket. That's a North Face running vest and a trail butter sample pack. Blue ticket, who's got a blue ticket? 525-570. 525-570. Oh, and I guess a shot ski as well, which you have to use as soon as you take possession of it. Blue ticket. Winner? He bought a lot of tickets. 570. Almost. You're too young for a shot ski, good point. All right, winner. We trust you. Okay, next up, we have an Osprey Transporter duffel bag for your next adventure overseas. Actually, stay here. Our snow's better. And a trail butter sample pack that's valued at $280. What color y'all want? How about orange? 669-846. Orange ticket, 669-846. You got a winner? All right, let's give her a big round of applause, team. Oh, there it is. Winner. There you go. Okay, next up, another North Face running vest and a trail butter sample pack valued at $225. What color y'all want? Huh? I got orange. 267-341. 267-341. Going once. The Sendit Foundation just won. All right. Best tracksuit of the evening, too, I might add. Okay, apparently we have a lot of North Face running vests and another trail butter pack. Another $225. What color, guys? I got red. 537-015. 537 0-1 winner. All right. Such a polite winner. Does everyone know Vicky? Vicky is an animal. Vicky runs a triple crown at Broken Arrow every year. Let's give Vicky a round of applause. Next up, we have a DMM Quick Draw 6-pack and Osprey Zealot 30-pack. What color, guys? I got orange, sorry, 298-594. 298-594. Did you win? All right. Next up, we have an Arc'teryx men's Adam hoodie and a North Face Snomad 34 backcountry ski pack. What color, team? I got red. 695-874. $375 right here. Stephanie is definitely Vanna Whiting that. 695-874. Going once. All right, winner. She's running. Excuse me. Okay, next up, we have another Arc'teryx Adam hoodie, synthetic insulation, and another North Face backcountry ski pack valued at $375. Who wants that? I got an orange ticket. Who's got an orange ticket? A lot of people. 669 239. Orange ticket.
Winner!
Well, come on then. Vicky, did you win again? Wait, we have dueling winners sitting right next to each other. Whose dog is this?
Boom!
All right, collect. Right there.
Oh, yeah.
The jacket's gonna fit you too. Congrats.
Oh, it smells good.
Victory smells good, apparently. Okay, next up, we have an Arc'teryx women's synthetic hoodie and a North Face Nomad pack for your next backcountry adventure, valued at $375. What color ticket, team? I got like a bluish. 525-949. 525-949. 525-949 going once. Going twice. Glenn Polson, come on. Let's embarrass Glenn Polson. Everyone clap for Glenn Polson. The women's jacket is totally gonna fit you, Glenn. Seriously, let's really clap for Glenn Polson. He is a legend in Tahoe. But I don't know if his ticket has the right number. Dude, that is totally not the number. I'm just kidding. You win. Let's give it up for Glenn. An icon in our midst. Okay, next up, a La Sportiva women's storm jacket and a pair of DPS carbon extendable poles valued at $300. Who wants that? Who's got a Sherbert ticket? 776-423. 776-423. Did you win, Mike? Mike works at Alpenglow. We are 100% checking his tickets. Check that ticket. Let's give it up for Mike. Okay, next up, we have a pair of La Sportiva climbing shoes of your choice. Thank you to our homie Rhett from La Sportiva. A Peak Designs 65-liter duffel and a trail butter pack valued at $500. Who's got a blue ticket? I got 482-972. 482-972. All right, Jess, come on, girl. Jess is probably tired. You have to excuse her pace. She was breaking trail for John all day. Okay, we're getting into some really good stuff. We have a Nerona Tamuk Down 750 jacket. That's a puffy. Another pair of La Sportiva climbing shoes and trail butter. Who wants some of that? What color ticket? Yellow? Oh, my voice just cracked. I got a red ticket. 633-087. 633-087. Going once. This is like Winner Central in the first three rows here. 633-087. All right. Let's give it up for this winner. Come on now. Okay, next up, we have a North Face Apex Future Light jacket and an avalanche transceiver from Mammut. $600. Who wants some of that? What color ticket? Red? Okay, I got red. 537058. 537058. Going once. 537058. Yeah? We have a prospect. We have a winner. Well, we know that, but not of the actual prizes. Okay, we're getting towards the grand prize. North Face Women's L5 bib and a Drizzle Future Light shell jacket and a backcountry ski pack valued at $650. What color, team? I got orange. 267613. $650. 267613. Going once. Going twice. 267613. Orange ticket. Going three times. Last chance. Okay. What color? Red. 537100. $650 for 537100. Someone's got to want this. Going once. 537100. Going twice. Going three times. What color do you want? I couldn't tell. Red. Look at that. Okay. 633355. 633355. This is seriously an epic prize. I think someone wants to win. All right, winner. Don't heckle the winners, please. I think we're, oh no, not quite the grand prize. We have another Nerona Puffy and two lift tickets to Palisades. That's $900. Who wants that? White. Who's got a white ticket? You are, if you don't win, you're the only person. 988-4504. White ticket. All right, don't hurt yourself. Let's give it up for enthusiasm, winner. All right, next up, we have our grand prize. A pair of DPS Pagoda Tour 112 skis and skins and extendable poles and I think even a backcountry ski pack. Who wants that prize? Come on, y'all, that's $2,100. All right, I got a green ticket. Was playing. I got an orange ticket. 267. Who's looking good so far? 267. 6. 2. 9. Orange ticket. 267. 629. Plus 4. 267-629. I know it's right because I asked them to put the spotlight on because I couldn't see the ticket numbers last time. Going once. 267-629. Come on. Go over those numbers. Twice. 267-629. Leanne, did you win? Okay. Going twice? All right. What color? All right, I got a white ticket. Who's got a white ticket? Sorry, it's a blue ticket, Greg. Someone else assuredly has white tickets. I got 482. Who's got a 482? $2,100. 607. Bro, you bought a lot of color tickets. Winner, come on, let's give it up for this winner. She has won $2,100. All right, everybody. Thank you again for coming. Who's fired up for Brette Harrington? Let's kill these lights and give her a big Tahoe warm welcome.
Cool. Sweet. Yes, thank you. Hey, everyone. I'm so honored to be here and so stoked to be presenting in Tahoe. It's my first presentation in Tahoe, and I'm from Tahoe, so I've got a lot of friends and family that are here tonight. And yeah, my name is Brette Harrington. I am a climber, skier, alpinist, and my presentation is gonna just kind of generally speak about my life and my motivation throughout my career as a professional athlete. So, on the right, that is me as a child, water skiing on Tahoe. And I was on the Heavenly Ski Foundation ski racing team. That's me skiing at the championships in Mammoth. I don't know if anyone out there has been on the ski racing teams around the lake. Anyone? Couple in the back? Okay. But I moved to New Hampshire in high school, and I joined a sport climbing team. And we would just go out rock climbing every day. It was incredible. It wasn't competitive. It was just like connecting with nature, learning about climbing. And something grabbed my curiosity right away. And this is what it was. We were out there in the forest clipping bolts. And who put these bolts up there? How did they get there? How did they put them up? And sometimes we would arrive at the cliff and a rope would already be up, even though only one of our coaches was there. And so I learned about rope soloing, certain techniques you can do to establish, first ascents, establish routes, and then ways you can climb solo. So this curiosity about climbing and just who does it, where it comes from, that led me to Squamish, British Columbia, where I lived for the past decade. Squamish, as many of you guys probably know, is really known for incredible granite climbing. I set it as a goal when I was 18 to just become the best climber I could possibly be. I didn't even have a goal of becoming a professional climber. I didn't even know that would be possible. But every weekend I would drive up from Vancouver because I was going to school in Vancouver and just climb as much as I could. And eventually I just moved to Squamish to climb, yeah, as much as I could. I was lucky enough to meet Marc Andre Leclerc, who's climbing here. He and I have done some incredible routes together. In 2015, we climbed the Muir Wall on El Cap. And then he and I both went back and climbed El Corazon, another free route on El Cap. Although I didn't succeed in 2016, and I went back last year and I sent it. So, thank you. Thank you. All right, I'm gonna warn you guys. The video footage I have here is very raw. It's just like, I wanted to let you know what it would be like to climb with Marc and I. So here, Marc and I are putting up a first ascent in Baffin Island, and we're just super excited. Let's see.
Here is Brette Harrington, going where no man or woman has ever gone before. Oh yeah. And the vistas are pretty good too. Woo-hoo! Hot damn.
Yeah, Marc's commentary is just incredible. yeah, so I've been on tons of expeditions around the world doing big wall climbs. And in 2016, so after Baffin, about 6 months later, I went down to Chile, to Torres del Paine, to try this huge alpine granite rock climb. But as you can tell from the photo, the rock was covered in ice. And up till now, I'd primarily just been a rock climber. I'd dabbled a little bit in ice with Marc Andre, but I wasn't much of an ice climber. So I improvised on this trip and learned a ton about winter climbing and how to ascend walls that are covered in ice. But it really sparked my passion to become an expert in all realms of climbing, not just rock. So I moved to the Canadian Rockies, and I started getting into ice climbing. I just wanted to be like efficient, and I wanted to be able to climb water ice 6. I wanted to be able to climb alpine routes. Here's a beautiful line, climbing in the Canadian Rockies. It's one of the most incredible, underappreciated mountain ranges of the world. And the ultimate goal is to be able to combine all of your skill sets to be able to climb mountains that require everything. So in 2019 and 2020, it took me 2 years to succeed on this mountain. I put up a first ascent, and I named it after Marc Andre because he passed away in an accident in Alaska in 2018. So I call this Mas Vision, M-A-S, Marc Andre's vision. But Mas Vision in Spanish is like more vision, meaning like more creativity in the mountains. And this video shows us summiting.
Yeah! There's David! Woo! Also on the top!
Yeah!
Incredible! So insane! Holy
here comes Horacio.
I can't even believe it.
We were so excited. The coolest summit of my entire life.
On Elmo.
Yeah, such a nice baby. Yeah!
Torre Eger is a very, very challenging mountain to ascend because it's a spire and it ends with really complex ice. This is called rime ice. And it's not solid. It's almost like just compacted snow. So you have to dig tunnels through the summit. We call it the summit mushroom because it billows out like a mushroom. And it's just been legendary in Patagonian climbing to dig the tunnel through the summit mushroom. And I got to do it. And it was the most memorable experience in my whole life, just like getting inside. And when you're digging upwards, the snow is just falling down on you. And it's like you're like crawling out a little wormhole and you're just pressing against it, trying to move up and not push out too hard because it's really soft. And then you just pop out on the summit. It was insane. Yeah. So alpinism came from rock climbing for me. For a lot of people, it's the opposite. But the ultimate goal was just to learn everything I could about climbing and to be able to put up first ascents, but not just in alpine climbing, in rock climbing, and be able to, like, for example, this is a route I established in Tahiti last year. And it's a blank wall of limestone rock. And after years and years of learning how to aid climb, artificial climb on hooks, I established these lines. And so in this photo, I'm establishing a route. And you can't tell, but I've got a drill hanging down below me. And I have hooks that I'm hanging on. And it requires free climbing. It requires aid climbing. And it's just like being able to improvise on the moment and use all these skills, I think, is the most important thing for me in climbing, to be able to ascend anything. I'm going to take you back to 2014, to British Columbia. I was climbing Mount Slessie. It is this giant wall in the North Cascades. And I was solo. So I was soloing, and I took this photo of these two climbers who were climbing an adjacent line. And behind them is the Chinese puzzle wall, this mythical wall that had never been climbed before. And I later, Marc Andre was also soloing this mountain. We were soloing together. And later I asked Marc about it, and he told me that it had been attempted a couple times. Fred Becky had gone there and tried to climb it. And we made it a goal of ours to go back and try it once we were good enough. But at that time, in 2014, I hadn't done anything like that. So this has been a project of mine throughout the past 7 years, is building out this wall and putting up first ascents. In 2016, Marc and I went back and did the first ascent of the wall. It was 400 meters. Here's Marc on the portal edge. We did it ground up, just aid climbing and free climbing as we went. That's Mount Slessie behind Marc. Here's some footage from the first ascent.
Big wall, Brett. Gonna go aid this spectacular splitter and clean the moss out of it to see if it'll go free. Oh, geez. She's got one piton and two bird beaks.
Yeah.
And some nuts. I bet she'll take nuts.
Black alien.
We'll see. Climb on. Oh, you're still daisied. Clap.
You don't always do things perfectly. Yeah. First ascending is really about exploring the unknown. You don't know what you're going to get into. You don't know how much gear, what kind of gear you're going to need to take up with you. And so you just do your best. And if you get shut down, you go back down. Try and refine your tactics and go back up. Now, when Marc and I established this route, that line was too hard for us to free climb. So we found an alternate route around the right side of it. But this past summer, I went back to these twin cracks and I freed them. And they were actually, yeah, it was really exciting. Marc always imagined that this would be on like the cover of the Fraser Valley climbing guidebook. And so maybe I'll send it in, see if they would take it. It's pretty sweet, yeah. Here's some photos that Elliot Bernhagen took this summer when I repeated our route. Hidden Dragon is what we called it. This is pitch 4. It's 12 pitches. It's really quite a magnificent wall. This is pitch 5. Beautiful splitter corners. And also a cool thing about first ascending is you get to devise your own topos And so I create these little topographical maps so that other people can follow where I went. And sometimes I give little hints as to what gear you might need if it's like super tricky, but I don't want to make it too obvious. I just like this. It's part of it for me. And I return to the wall, and I put up three more routes. Here's a photo from Crouching Tiger, 2018. Manchu Walk, 12G, 2019. And the last one that I completed in the last 2 years is Cajun Moon. And that's Leslie again behind. Here is the wall. So, any of you avid granite rock climbers?
No.
Don't worry, I'll get to skiing soon. Let's go to alpinism first. Oh, yeah. So sometimes you just find yourself in a snow cave high up on a mountain and wonder, how are we going to get down? So I'll take you on a little journey to alpine climbing and how you get there. So this is a mountain in the Canadian Rockies called Epaulette. And one day I was out ice climbing and I saw this beautiful line that I thought would be a fun thing to try with a friend of mine. So I invited Dylan Cunningham, a partner that I have climbed a ton with. We've done a bunch of ice routes, a bunch of alpine routes together, and I thought Dylan would be the right partner. It was super challenging ice climbing to get there. Here we are at night.
Dylan's boiling water for our meals. And I dug us this snow cave. You can sleep in there.
Yeah, so we spent so long digging out that snow cave, and it was actually an incredible bivy site and a really like one-of-a-kind experience to bivy way up there on the wall. But in the morning, this is the view that we had. It was just snowing. It had been snowing all night, and so we were forced to rappel. And this is what it looked like. You can see Dylan at the bottom. Just waterfalls of spindrift all around you. Just absolutely amazing place to be. But we couldn't go up, so we had to go down. There is the view of the mountain from below. So sometimes you fail, and sometimes you succeed. So Dylan and I went to a different mountain in the springtime that had better conditions. In the Canadian Rockies over the winter, big cornices build up, just like here, from all the wind and snow. So I found this line that didn't have an overhead cornice, and it was the east face of Mount Niblock, and had never been climbed before. So we started out at 2 a.m. in the morning, and it was like 2 a.m. in the dark, and there were northern lights. It's really special starting in these like really early alpine starts in the northern part of the world because you might experience something like that, or you might see Starlink. That scared me, let's just say. I had thought it was aliens. Yeah. And then slowly as you pass up or climb up the mountain, you start to get a bigger perspective of where you are and how small you are. So we climbed higher and higher. That's me. You can see my like little silhouette on the ridge. And even higher. And I like this photo. It's kind of tricky to see because it's dark, but you can see Dylan's footprints down low. And even below that, there were other rock buttresses that we climbed up. So you can't really get a good perspective on how big this mountain is. But we felt very, very small, let's just say. And this is a perfect example of where multiple skill sets combine to be able to climb something like this. So it wasn't all rock, and it wasn't all ice. Like right here, I have my mountain boots on my back with my crampons attached to my harness, and I'm in rock shoes. But at the top of this pitch, I transitioned back into my crampons and boots and did some more snow climbing. And that happened a bunch on this route where you had to just transition in between your skills. Here's Dylan climbing up over the final summit. And here he is on the ridge, looking down. That's Lake Louise is right down there. And yeah, so we put up this really cool route. And I just liked that it's sort of like in the winter when we went to try a pollet, we failed. And then we just modified our plans, worked together over the year, and then went back and succeeded with something like this. It's pretty cool. All right. Some people might say skiing is better than climbing. She is one of them. This is Christina Lusty, who may be here tonight. Christina, are you here? I was skiing with her earlier, but she's one of my best friends. We've done a ton of missions together, and she is the best skier I know. She has an incredible vision for where she wants to take skiing, and she's been doing these interesting alpine ski descents. And so she's been, over the years, trying to acquire more alpine skills. And for me, I'm just attracted to learning about new visions, and like hers. And so together we teamed up. I like this photo because I'm the rock climber and she's the skier. And we team up, and together we can combine and become stronger. So we've done some really, really interesting ski lines together over the past couple years. But really, I've learned so much about snow stability, about how to assess weather, how to assess terrain through a skier's eye, but through Christina's eye. She's a ski guide. She's gone through lots of courses in university. She was in this mountain university where they learned about, like, mountain skills. So, yeah, she has, like, formal training, unlike me. And what I find interesting about skiing with Christina is that she has such a high level cardio, and she expects you to have that too. So she's not gonna wait. So I'm always just like trying so hard to keep up with her because she is just a machine. And it's always really fun. So we've gotten into some interesting objectives over the years, combining skiing with climbing, such as this line. This is a line in the Gold Range outside of Revelstoke that has a hanging serac, so a hanging piece of glacier in the middle of the line. You can't really see it in this photo, but it's up there. Now you can see a little bit more zoomed in that hanging glacier, and it requires ice climbing to ascend. So me, the ice climber, led the ice on the route, but it's funny because you're like ice climbing with your skis on your back and crampons, and it's just more involved, I'd say. And here's Christina skiing down. Actually you can see us rappelling. We had to rappel on our way down over the glacier. It's pretty small. And skiing with Christina, so the top 200 meters is a steep snow slope that leads to the glacier below, but it's very, very steep. It felt like free soloing, and that's the only way I can relate to what Christina does in the mountains, is that it's a free solo type of ski. No fall terrain. Yeah. Here she is starting down. But we've done a bunch of interesting lines like this. So I put together this, like, sorry, there's no audio on this video, but just one day we went out and skied this really cool line in the spring. And so I made this little video. This is in the Purcell Mountain Range in British Columbia. She, myself, and Drew Smith, a friend of ours, climbed this line on Farnham. And did, I think it was the second descent of the line, but it also required some alpine skills. We rappelled and did some scrambling to get there. But the difference between she and I is that she is willing to ski and, like, really ski it, whereas I, like, get down. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. She... Yeah. So we'd been wanting to go on a big expedition together, and because of COVID, we weren't able to until last year. And I proposed going back to Baffin Island, where I had been with Marc Andre, not for climbing this time, but for skiing. And we had invited, well, Hillary Nelson. Hillary was on our team, and Hillary's like, I want to go. I want to go with you guys. And we were so excited. Hillary had been in both of our minds just this legend, and we were so honored that she wanted to come with us. And Hillary was like, Emily should come. Emily Harrington, my sister. And so, she's not really my sister. I'm just kidding. Yeah. But Hillary and Emily have done a bunch of skiing together and just alpine climbing together. So the four of us went to the Arctic. Baffin Island is the island just left of Greenland up in the Arctic Circle. Here's Hillary, just somebody that I admire to the highest level. Hillary unfortunately passed away in September, but I wish that she could be here tonight because her energy just fills the room and it makes you feel good just being around her. And that's how we felt in Baffin. Just having her as part of the team made us feel solidified. She was such a leader, such a captain, so kind and on top of it and dialed. And we were really grateful and honored to have her. I'll go back. Yeah. Emily Harrington, she might be watching on, I think, online tonight because she has a little one at home. But yeah, I got to ski with Emily today. She's an incredible climber, versatile in all skill sets, and just super friendly and fun. And it was great to have Emily. And of course, my badass ski partner, Christina. Can't go skiing without her, so. Yeah, so we went up to Clyde River, British Columbia. This is actually in Canada. It's domestic. The Canadians can go there during COVID. I'm just kidding. So these are the young kids that took us into the fjord that we wanted to get to. So Clyde River is the closest town to where we wanted to get, but it was 150 kilometers to get out there. And with Christina's help, we found these hunters, local hunters that were willing to drive us out there on snow machines. But they're 19. I think one of them's 15. Yeah, the guy I was riding with, he's only 15 years old. They're just smoking cigarettes. They were really, really fun. The Arctic is an interesting place. It's like being on the moon. It's nowhere I've ever been before, and it's so beautiful. The people are beautiful. They're just up there living off the land. They would bring us caribou and eat it raw, something I had never experienced. Also, just raw fish that they had hunted from or found in the lakes. They were fishing. Yeah, they're really cool people, so it was a special time. Here's our camp. And the four of us, plus we had two filmers and a photographer with us. This was a special trip. So the four of us were skiing these 1,000-meter couloirs every day. And we were lucky because it had snowed a meter before we got there. That never happens really in the Arctic. Everyone said it was an anomaly, especially in the spring. So we really lucked out with the weather, we lucked out with the team, the dynamic, the energy, absolutely everything went well. Because typically during the winter in Baffin Island, it can get down to negative 50 Celsius. It can maybe not even snow. The couloirs could have been rocky. We didn't know what to expect before we got there, but we had perfect conditions. A lot of the time, it was skiing powder. Here's Hillary just cruising down this line. Here's Christina flying down. Yeah, and we were out there for 11 days, and 10 of which we skied 1,000-meter couloirs. We were just going every day. Here's Emily. And on the way in, Christina and I saw this line that really appealed to us because it had a glacier in the center. And as the climber, and as a skier, she and I were both like, that's the line we want to do. We want to try that. But we had no idea how big it was. We were looking on, we had a drone, so our drone pilot was like trying to fly up there and scout it for us, but we really couldn't tell how big the glacier was going to be. We analyzed it from the bottom, looking up. It looked like it had a hanging snow field that had some glaciated sections at the top, and then the sérac, and then a lower winding couloir. And so from the drone, we flew over and could see a south-facing couloir up the backside of the mountain. So we planned to hike that side of the mountain and then drop right over the top into the north side, which is what we're looking at right here. Yeah, here's just like an up-close view of the glacier. I had looked at it and thought the right side looked the most stable to do the rappels from. So we prepared our gear. We kept it super light, just a handful of pitons and 2 60-meter rappel or ropes. And then we started up the south side, and it became very, very hot. It took us 3 hours to hike up there, but it was just the two of us on this mission. Hillary and Emily chose to ski other lines this day. So just Christina and I were hiking up, and it was so hot. We were boiling. Every step you took, snow would ball on the bottom of your crampon, so it felt like we had 10 pounds on each step. You'd lift your foot and then have to clap it to your leg and then step up, clap. And this line ended up being 1,200 meters, so it was a really big line to hike just the two of us in that condition.
It's 12:50. We've been hiking since around 10, and it is so hard going. Each step, we have to kick the balls of snow out of the crampons. It's heavy, heavy snow, and so hot. But we're making it, little by little.
And we made it to the summit. It was so cool. Yeah. It's really cool working with Christina when it's just the two of us. I've spent so much time with Christina. I've lived with her for many winters now. And so we just get along really well. You don't even have to question anything. We both, it's like, I guess, when you live with somebody, it could be your husband or your best friend. You just understand them, and that's how I feel with Christina. So at the summit, I started down climbing a little bit to test the snow. It looked glaciated, so I thought maybe it would be thin, and sure enough, it was quite thin. So I pounded in a piton to build an anchor, and then we did the first pitch just wrapping over. You can see Christina slowly wrapping over just to see what the rollover would be like, and it ended up being totally fine. So after the first pitch on the rope, we pulled the ropes, and we skied down to the top of the glacial face. This might be a video. Yeah. A very quick video of what the skiing looked like on that upper face. It was really cold snow and really chattery snow, so it was hard compressed from the wind and then had a lot of little balls, so it was very, very careful skiing. You couldn't just shred the way we wanted. But we got to the top of the glacier, and it ended up being gigantic, like way bigger than we had expected. Here I'm rappelling off of a V-thread, so I built an anchor into the ice and started rappelling down. This is what we ended up rappelling down. You can see me at the top and Christina skiing there, and it was huge. It was 200 meters, I think. So we did a full 60-meter rappel, and then another full 60-meter rappel, and then the ropes got stuck. So stuck, they wouldn't budge at all. And the two of us were there with the ropes trying to pull it down, but it was also like precarious terrain. We'd clipped into a little horn that I'd slung, but it wasn't the best stance, and we both decided we needed to cut the ropes. So I climbed back up, belt another anchor into the ice, reached as high as I could and cut the ropes. And then we ended up doing 4 micro wraps off these like 10 meter sections of rope to make it down. In the final rappel, Christina's like, let's just get out of here. And so we just rappelled off the ends of the rope and just like splat into the snow at the bottom. It was, yeah, I mean, she calls it the rope splat. I had never heard that term before, but it's now in my vocabulary. Yeah, here's the line. We call it Polar Moon. We got to name it. There's an adjacent line on another mountain called the Polar Star Couloir. It's one of the 50 classics. We also skied that with Emily and Hillary. And that one is just so beautiful and long and winding. And the Polar Moon is kind of like the dark side. The dark, shady moon. These yellow dots are the rappels that I ended up making. The first one, the second one, and then the tiny little ones. Here we are at the bottom, just so excited. It was a really cool adventure. Yeah. And once we got to the bottom, all of our friends were there. It was like a complete change of scenery. Hillary and Emily were there. Drew was there. And here are the lines that we skied on that trip. One day I went ice climbing. But yeah, just like beautiful ski lines all over the place. It seemed like no matter where you went, you were going to hit something amazing. And here the four of us are just super happy. It was the most successful expedition I have ever gone on. And I think that happened for a reason. Some reason the world came together and we all just had such a great time. Maybe it was for Hillary, maybe it was for us, I don't know. But yeah, what a great crew. Okay. So that is the end of my presentation. I hope, I don't know what time it is, but yeah, I want to thank my sponsors, North Face, La Sportiva, and DMM. And I really want to thank everyone here at Alpenglow. It's really cool that you invited me. Thank you.
All right, y'all, come on, give it up for Brett. That was amazing.
Oh, okay. Cool. Thank you.
Brett's going to stick around afterwards and chat if anyone wants to. We'll see you back for the one and only Anna Pfaff in a few weeks. Thanks for coming. Enjoy the pow. Okay.